Let us welcome our dear brothers, our chief guests, and our guests of honor with a big round of applause.
A lot like Christmas. So the bells will start, and the thing that will make them ring is the carol that you sing right within your heart. There is no name so sweet on earth, no name so sweet in heaven. The name before his wondrous birth, to Christ the Savior given. It is Christmas in the heart that puts Christmas in the air.
A very good morning to one and all present here. Dear friends, it's that time of year again. December has come, and with it, all the joy.
Well-decorated lawn, a lovely crib, the amazing Christmas tree, snowman, delicious cakes, Santa Claus, gifts, candy sticks, and the bright and shining star.
Star of wonder, star of night, star with royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us to thy perfect light.
The air is filled with Christmas buzz. We have entered the shorter days, longer nights, and everyone's thinking about gifts. It's the most magical time for those who are surrounded by family and friends. How many times have you thought as a child that Santa Claus will come and give gifts to you? Many times you may actually receive them, although they are presents from your family.
Such is the craze of Santa Claus. His gifts, jingle bells, and Christmas trees associated with the festival of Christmas. It is a festival which attracts people of all faith towards it, being one of those festivals which is widely celebrated all over the world. It is important for us to know about this festival we call Christmas. Christmas is a season of great joy. It is a time of God showing his great love for us. It can be a time of healing and renewed strength. The spirit of Christmas is in the togetherness. It's in the thought to which you put into thinking about others. It's a selfless time where we forgive, take stock of what's important, and become better versions of ourselves.
May I now invite Michelle to welcome the gathering. Unto us a child is given, unto us a son is born. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. John chapter 1, verse 4. A very good morning to our beloved principal, Reverend Brother Thomas, our Vice Principal, Reverend Brother Isidore, our dear chief guest for today, Reverend Father Joseph Patrick, our guests of honor, Reverend Father Thomas and Reverend Father Prasad, our loving teachers and my dear fellow Michaelites. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to this special day of splendor and goodwill, a day filled with joy, laughter, happiness, love, mirth, and merriment. This day is made even more special as we have amidst us Reverend Father Patrick Joseph, who is the parish priest of St. Louis Church Adyar and has a long list of illuminating works before his name. Dear Father, we are indeed honored to have such an inspiring personality like you amidst us. We also have with us Reverend Father Thomas and Reverend Father Prasad. Your presence is what makes this day truly cherishable for all of us. A hearty welcome to you, fathers. We thank you for accepting our invitation and sparing your valuable time for us. Once again, I accord the most hospitable and joyous welcome to one and all present here. Thank you.
There are a very few things in life that gives us unconditional love and happiness. Sweet blossoming of flowers is one such of events. As a token of our love and appreciation, we would like to present a bouquet and a gift to our chief guest. May I request our principal, Reverend Brother Thomas, to give away the bouquet, our vice principal, Reverend Brother Isidore, to give away the gift to our chief guest. We also welcome our guest of honor, Reverend Father Prasad, with flowers. May I request our principal, Reverend Brother Thomas, to give away the bouquet. Thank you, brother. The words of the Bible have life. God works through these words. The Bible speaks with power and practicality to everything you are facing, thinking, and feeling. The God who seems so distant to you in this moment is actually near and active through his words. May I now invite Arik to read the word of God.
A reading from the book of John, chapter 1, verses 9 to 14. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came to be through him, but the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, but his own people did not accept him. But to those who did accept him, he gave power to become children of God. To those who believe in his name, who were born not by natural generation, not by human choice, not by a man's decision, but of God. And the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. And we saw his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Prayer lays hold of God's plan and becomes the link between his will and its accomplishment on earth. Amazing things happen when we are given the privilege of being the channels of the Holy Spirit as we are rooted in love, power, and knowledge of Jesus. Prayer is the beat of our heart, the attitude of our mind, the song on our tongue, and the direction of our thoughts. May I request Anya Peter to lead us in prayer.
Let us join our hands and close our eyes for the prayer. And I say unto you, ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. Father, as we celebrate again the keeping of your promise, the coming of Messiah, the birth of your Son, we ask for strength to have the faith of Mary, who was blessed for believing that she would bear your Son. We ask for joy to be astonished as a shepherd by the message of the angels that Emmanuel has come. We ask for humble hearts to be selfless as the wise men, bearing gifts across the miles, to bow low before our King. We ask for courage to follow our Savior's path, from life to death to life again, and to find our home with you. Lord, as we stand before you as a Michaelite family, thank you for using this gathering to remind us of the Merry Christmas we are about to have. Lord, help us end this year cheerfully and have a glorious new year. We ask for grateful thoughts and good desires in your name. Lord, bless our brothers, our chief guest, our teachers, parents, the students appearing for their board exams, our office staffs, and our helpers. As our Pope rightly said, let us never be the reason for someone's wrinkle in their face, but be a twinkle in their eyes. All this we ask through your most precious name. Amen.
The spirit of Christmas exists in harmonious carols, like those sung by angels on the day of Christ's birth. Nothing says Christmas is here quite like the melodious strain of festive music meeting our chilly eardrums. And Christmas carols especially usher in a brilliant warmth and joy that brightens up the winter months for all. Now, let us welcome our dear kindergartners who are here to uplift our Christmas spirit with their enchanting carols. Of the arts. It is the most perfect symbol of the activity of God and his angels. Dance is meditation in movement, or walking into silence where every movement becomes prayer. Now, we shall have the invocation dance by the students of standards 6, 7, and 8.
Baby boy would save our sons and daughters. that your baby boy is Lord of all creation. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nation?
Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect creation?
Of the birth of Jesus Christ in human flesh in Bethlehem offers us the message of hope, steadfastness, and obedience of faith in the incarnate Son of God. It challenges us not to lose hope and faith in God. In spite of difficulties and seemingly hopelessness of our present situation, Christmas teaches us that the God is always present and does not abandon his people in moments of trials and difficulties.
Under turbulent like ours today, what is the spiritual importance of Christmas for us? In a world characterized by myriads of man-made violence, persecutions, wars, as well as insecurity of life and property, occasioned primarily by fear, greed, and bad leadership, what is the significance of Christmas for Christians and non-Christians alike? In a world, in our world of today, where human life appears to have lost its value and meaning, what is the message of the infant Jesus born in a manger at Bethlehem for all? Let us now witness the birth of our Lord Savior in the musical nativity play to know the true meaning behind Christ's birth on earth.
Thank you. The Roman Emperor Augustus Caesar, who ruled Israel at that time, proclaimed for an order of census.
Joseph took his wife, the expectant Mary, on a hard journey to Bethlehem, town of David, to register their names. Joseph took his beloved wife Mary on a donkey. When they arrived in Bethlehem, they knocked on every door of the town, looking for a place to stay. Lots of people had gone there to be enrolled, and all the inns of the town were full. Mary and Joseph had nearly gave up searching for a place to stay. But there were no rooms in any of the inns in Bethlehem, as many people had come to register.
Sir, my wife is tired from traveling and it's very cold outside. Can you please give us a room to stay for the night?
I'm so sorry, sir. I have no rooms left.
My wife is tired from traveling and it's very cold outside. Can you please give us a room to stay for the night?
I'm very sorry, but I don't have any more rooms left.
Sir, my wife is tired from traveling and it's very cold outside. Can you please give us a room to stay for the night?
I'm so sorry, sir. All my rooms are full with guests from across the country. All I can offer is my stable outside at the back where we keep all animals.
Thank you, sir.
So, Mary and Joseph went to stay in the stable. It was a very difficult situation and the place dilapidated to bring forth a new life into the world. But Mary and Joseph made the best of it.
When the time soon came for the baby to be born, Mary gave birth to Jesus. They wrapped little Jesus in swaddling clothes they had. They laid the Son of God in a manger, a trough used to feed animals, symbolizing that Jesus was to be the only true and living bread from heaven, and that he will become the real food for believers in the real presence of the Eucharist.
Of Christ is the joy for this world. As the finite, evanescent, and temporal world was chosen by God to partake in his infinite glory, and the humanity which embraced death through sin was redeemed by the Son of God. The world looks at this event as yet another religious festival and equates this with ordinary celebrations. It is the victory of God, not like victories we recognize by killing or defeating an evildoer, but a victory where the Son of Man was born to redeem us through his sacrificial death on the cross. This love of God, which invites all of us to celebrate the joy of Christmas, resonates in the song of the angels as peace to those on whom his favor rests. Yes, God promises peace to all those who seek him and observe his words.
All other festivities offer fun and happiness that will last till the end of that event, but only the birth of Jesus gifts us with peace and everlasting happiness to those who honor God with their word, deed, and life on earth. The old world and all its great leaders perished at the end of their short lifespan on this earth, but the memories of them has faded away with the passing of time. But the joy of Christmas grows and renews afresh in each one of us, heeding to his call of love.
God's loving message is to love one another as he loves us. We are called to gaze upon the holy countenance of Jesus and deliver the Father's message of mercy to those around us. As our Holy Father, Pope Francis, says, "How many weary and oppressed people we meet every day, in our school, in our neighborhood, and at the doctor's office. It is through our eyes that the gaze of Jesus rests upon each one of those weary and oppressed souls."
Christmas is indeed a call to prepare the way for the Lord, inviting us to turn our hearts to our Maker, cleansing ourselves in realization that we are the temples of his Holy Spirit, enabling Christ to work through us.
As we begin to watch the Nativity now and relive the moments of Christ's birth, let us make it a prayer and turn our hearts to God.
Thank you.
choose a life of poverty so that his children might share the richness of his glory. 2 Corinthians 8:9 says, "Know the gracious act of our Lord Jesus Christ, who for your sake became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich."
And there were shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over the flocks at night.
To them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were amazed and filled with heavenly joy.
Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. We bring you a great joy.
Good news for the people across the world.
Today in Bethlehem, a Savior is born. You'll find a baby wrapped in clothes lying in the manger.
Glory to the God in the highest, and on earth, peace to men of good will.
Come on. Then the shepherds hurried off to seek Mary and Joseph and the divine baby as foretold to them. Now Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the time of Herod the king. There came three wise men from the east searching for the birth of the great king by the astronomical sign of a new comet. These three important people were also known as the three kings as well as the Magi. They were pious and highly knowledgeable persons of repute who knew all the secrets of the stars. A bright star rose in the sky and they followed it to worship the King of Kings who was born as a human baby whose birth was foretold before many centuries.
Jesus the child. They prostrated before him and worshipped him, recognizing him as the King of Kings. The first wise men brought gold to salute the king. Frankincense was the gift from the second because he knew that Jesus was the Son of God. The third wise men brought myrrh, used in Jewish burial customs, symbolizing that Jesus would save the world by his holy death and resurrection. King Herod asked the three wise men to let him know where the child was born. However, they were warned in a dream not to go back to him. So they took another route to return to their countries.
Bye.
Of the forest came to know about their lord's birth. They quickly made their way to the stable, carrying little gifts for him.
About the good news?
Yes, I heard about the good news. The Messiah is born.
Come on then, let's give our little gifts to him.
I will give him cotton and twig for his manger.
Sweet honeycomb for baby Jesus. I will give him fresh and juicy carrots.
This log of wood will shelter the manger from the cold wind.
I will give him a sweet and tasty bananas.
We will give him our beautiful feathers to decorate his cradle.
The animals never perceived that some of their gifts were useless for the infant. Instead, with a heart of thanksgiving, they gave all that they thought was precious for them.
Let us escape!
with sparkling lights and pretty adorned gifts, all neatly stacked and decked.
Oh, delicious cakes, pies, and new clothes, and of course, Santa's gifts.
Christmas fills our hearts with joy as we think of gifts, lights, and the holiday spirit. But remember, Christmas means something more. Christmas is the start of time. It's the start of human history. And without the birth of Christ, the birth of mankind doesn't have any meaning beyond a death. It is the birth of a Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us now travel back in history to unravel the real events.
Thousand years ago, in the town of Nazareth, lived a young virgin named Mary, the only beloved child of her saintly parents, Saint Joachim and Saint Anne. She was raised in the great Jerusalem temple since her childhood. As she grew up, as per the will of God, she was engaged to a noble carpenter named Joseph, from the tribe of Judah, a descendant of King David.
To have you as our child, you are a precious gift from God to us.
The time came forth for the Messiah to be born. The Lord, who never turned towards the fallen angels, stretched forth his hands of mercy to restore the fallen human race, stepping down from his heavenly throne and drawing them closer to his love. Blessed indeed is the human race to cherish on such godly love. The angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town of Galilee called Nazareth to announce the glad tidings of Christ's birth to Mary. The entire Holy Trinity was pleased with her.
Hail, favored one, the Lord is with you. Do not be afraid, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you are to conceive in your womb and bear a son. You shall call him Jesus, for he will be great. He will be called Son of the Most High God. And the Lord God will give him the throne of David, his father. He will rule over the house of Jacob, and of his kingdom there will be no end.
Can this be, since I'm not married?
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, Son of God. Behold, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived in her old age. This is the sixth month for her who was called barren, for nothing is impossible with God.
I am the handmaid of the Lord. May it be done to me according to your word.
The angel departed, leaving Mary filled with grace and excited about the news of becoming the mother of God, who will soon become her one and only son.
Thank you.
Joseph, to whom Mary was betrothed, found out Mary was pregnant before their marriage. He, being a just man and not willing to publicly expose her, was minded to put her away privately. But while he thought of these things, he felt tired and gradually fell asleep. Behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in his sleep.
Joseph, Joseph, descendant of King David, wake up. Joseph, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for she is conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to call him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.
Joseph rises up and decides to follow the will of God. Mary, rising up in those days, went to the countryside with haste into a city called Judah. She enters the house of Zechariah and salutes Elizabeth. And it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the infant leaped in her womb. Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and cried out in a loud voice,
"Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And whence is this to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, as soon as the sound of your salutation sounded in my ears, the infant in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed are you that have believed, for those things shall be accomplished that were spoken to you by the Lord."
My soul magnifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. He looks on his servant in her lowliness. Henceforth, all ages will call me blessed. The Almighty works marvels for me. Holy is his name. His mercy is from age to age on those who fear him. He puts forth his arm in strength and scatters the proud-hearted. He casts the mighty from their thrones and raises the lowly. He fills the starving with good things, sends the rich away empty. He protects Israel, his servant, remembering his mercy, the mercy promised to our fathers, to Abraham and his sons forever.
Mary abode with her for about 3 months. Then she returned to her own home.
Human beings. Wars bring in death, destruction, disease, and ruin in its way. One has only to look back to the havoc that war has wrought in various countries over the world. Wars bring in huge crises, poverty, unemployment, starvation, violence, and abuse of different kinds, leading to the greater destruction of an individual. Wars also lead many people to drugs and alcoholism, wrecking the morale of the society. The most disturbing side of modern wars is that they tend to become global and may engulf the entire world in its jaws. But there are people who consider war to be something grand and heroic. This especially affects the youth and their ideas of being heroic and regard it as something that brings out the best in men. This is especially so now that wars are fought with atom bombs and nuclear weapons. But this does not change the fact that war is a terrible and dreadful calamity.
Great intellectual men who advocated on the principle of non-violence and taught men the theory of brotherhood have all perished. In spite of all their good efforts, weapons have always been used. Military force has always been employed. Clash of arms has always occurred. War has always been waged. War is the enemy of all of humanity and humankind. Nothing good can ever be achieved out of it. Hence, it cannot be glorified in any form. It not only hampers the development of the nations, but also uproots social cohesiveness. It slows down the pace of progress in mankind.
Wars are not the solution to problems. Instead, they generate problems and create hatred among nations. The world today is ravaged with wars, communal riots, and pestilence, which in reality isn't biowarfare. We can talk about war in general, but have we ever realized where war originates from? It stems from an individual human greed and fight for power and supremacy to establish evil dominance over other nations. It is ultimately this attitude of mankind that resonates through nations. The world still believes in the theory of the survival of the fittest and to surpass that which they think is weak. Isn't it so contrary to the message of Christmas and the love that Christ has bestowed upon us? Jesus Christ is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, with complete authority over heaven and earth. But he himself emptied himself, made himself so lowly and weak to redeem us. He, the Lion of Judah, became the meek lamp of God for us through his life, death, and glorious resurrection. In this war-driven world, Christmas is the reminder of God's unending love and promises of peace. How can we celebrate Christmas at an era like this? How can we make the promises of Christ's love and peace relevant and relatable to a war-driven world that is torn asunder by so much of divisions? We may ponder at times and be perplexed on how to live out the values and virtues that Christ wants us to pursue. What does Christmas mean to us in times like these? To the one who walks in hunger and starvation, food is Christmas to them. To those burdened in sorrow and pain, our comforting words of reassurance is Christmas to them. To the homeless and downtrodden, our merciful hands extending shelter is Christmas to them. To those who are sick and bedridden in deep pain, medicines and our loving hands of warmth and care is Christmas to them. When we arise, use our feet to walk for God and use our hands in reaching out to comfort, care, and to shelter those in need, we begin to live out Christ and radiate the joy of Christmas to others.
It is at this juncture we should turn our eyes and look up to the saints and holy men of the church who have lived like Christ and have been the forerunners of our faith and hope in spreading the love of Christmas. The holy men of the church have lived out Christ to their exemplary life of holiness, making Christ the center of their lives, living with humility, obedience unto God, and most importantly, being empathetic towards those in need and reaching out to others, which is the crux of Christmas.
We are called to imitate the life of Christ and emulate the example of the saints and bring the light of Christ into the lives of others through our warmth and love. This is the real meaning of Christmas. The little that we do to others in need is the Christmas that God wants us to celebrate.
Dearest angel, I bought a small teddy bear and some flowers to give baby Jesus, but it all got tattered and torn in the war. Will Jesus still accept my gift?
My dearest little one, the kingdom of heaven belongs to little children like you. Your holiness and the purity of your soul upholds the very foundations of the world. So, dearest children, walk in holiness. Do not get deviated by the ways of the world, for you are God's instruments of hope and peace. Go ahead, my dearest little one, and give your gift to baby Jesus. I am sure the glorious bells of heaven will chime in gratitude for your sweet little gift.
Of Christ's love, reach out to others in need, be living tabernacles for God, and enthrone Him as the King of our hearts. Become His ambassadors of peace and royal soldiers, imitating the lives of all the glorious saints who carried Christ in their hearts, establishing His kingdom of love and peace. May all those who encounter us see the Christ in us and spread the message of Christmas.
Thank you. gift that brings people together with creativity and music. Dance is one of the most divine form of art that brings unity, joy, and happiness. Surely the most important gift to remember at Christmas beyond kindness, acceptance, and joy is remembering how lucky we are to dance, celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let us sit back and enjoy the poetry of footsteps by the students of Standard 3.
Our chief guest, Reverend Father Patrick Joseph, to address the gathering.
Dear Reverend Brother Principal, the Assistant Principal, dear Lordship, fathers, sisters, staff, and my dear students, good morning to you all. At first, I wish you all a very, very happy Christmas. Today's program I witnessed wonderfully well. The nativity scene, I always advise they must have three things in the nativity play. The first one is the presentation of the nativity scene. Secondly, the creativity. Thirdly, the interpretation of the nativity scene. As in all the three in your nativity play, all the three were there. So I do appreciate for a wonderful presentation. And here, the angelic choir beautifully sang all the songs, and I do appreciate them for the wonderful voice and the singing. And all the dances, the colorful dances, I heard from the principal, Father Thomas, Brother Thomas, there were about 600 children participating in this program. I never seen any school like that. So I appreciate all of you, all the participants. One small event like this nativity play was enacted in one of the schools, and they decorated nice grip, and they arranged all the statues, they covered. So at the particular time, they want to remove that cover. So like me, a priest was there, principal, and all the staff gathered in front of the grip. They removed the veil. They got surprised. All the statues were there, except baby Jesus. Baby Jesus statues missing there. Then the father asked the principal, what happened to baby Jesus? And the principal asked all the teachers, what happened? Then they were searching for the baby Jesus. What happened to the baby Jesus in the grip? Then some boys came and reported. One boy carried the baby Jesus and having the cycle there, kept the baby Jesus in the cycle and doing the doubles. Then they brought him. What happened? Why you had taken the baby Jesus? He said, if I score centum and max, I will give treat to Jesus. That's why he took baby Jesus in the cycle, he said. Yes, my dear students, you all need to have Jesus in your heart, in your midst. That's why we celebrate the Christmas. It had taken place 2,000 years back. But every year we celebrate, it's because Jesus must come to us in our midst. It is a special birth. I can give a lot of examples. One is historical birth. It divided two, the whole history, before Christ, after Christ. It is an expected birth. Before birth of our Lord Jesus, many foretold about Jesus, how he will be born of the Virgin, and which place Bethlehem, how the star will appear, everything was narrated. And also this was a birth, indeed, one side historical, the other side foretold, the other side miraculous birth. That's why you have seen the angel's appearance, and star appearance, and magis came, all those things. It's a miraculous birth. And also this is a sharing birth. That's why father, sisters are there. They are going to share the Christmas with you. Because God shared our humanness. That's the Christmas. That's the Christmas. God shared his love with us. That's what we read. God so loved the world that he has given his only son to us. And finally, I say, it is an obedient birth. Jesus obeyed to God the Father and came into us like us and born in the manger. Therefore, when Jesus will come into your heart, in your midst, if you are obedient to the parents, obedient to the teachers and the elders, certainly Jesus will come into you. God bless. Happy Christmas.
I take this opportunity to thank Reverend Father Patrick.
Thank you, Father, for enlightening us with your inspiring speech.
So in a special way, I thank Father Patrick, our parish priest, for coming over and giving us a Christmas message. I invite Father Thomas to come here to share a short message. Father Thomas is running a hospital in the outskirts of Chennai. You know, there are people those who are heard about destitute, people those who are dying. For them, he is running a special hospital and is taking care of them. So I just want Father to share his experience with his short message. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Brother, and wish you all a very happy Christmas. Father Thomas, I run hospices, not hospital, five hospices in Tamil Nadu. இறக்குந்தருவாயிலுள்ள அநாதைகள் காப்பகங்கள் ஹாஸ்பிசஸ் ஃபார் த டையிங் டெஸ்டிடியூட் Yes, thank you. In those five hospices, we have on an average 4 deaths every day. Roadla, railway station, la bridge kadila, pendu naari, pulu pudichu, manitha maan vilandhu, irakkunda kudumbathal kaividapattu, roadla kidakkiravangala mattum naanga eduthittu poi paramarikkirom. We look after them. 750 people. We are looking after, and I was about to tell Brother Thomas that poor Mary and Joseph were kneeling too long in the manger. What is manger? Well, there are cows and donkeys and all that, isn't it? Very smelly, dirty place. Well, my manger, the five mangers I have, also are smelly and dirty. Why? Because they have no bowel control or bladder control. அவங்கள அறியாமலேயே ஒன்றுக்கு ரெண்டுக்கு போயிட்டே இருப்பாங்க. 35% of our patients have no bowel control or bladder control. Just like the cows and donkeys in the manger. And those who come in will be sometimes in the morning time, they will be closing their nose because it is smelling. Well, that is how Jesus is being reborn every day. Even in our city, most of our patients are brought from the city of Chennai, where we have 22 million people. And these people die in ignominy. What we do is try to give them a dignity, dignified death in our play hospices. I thank Brother Thomas and all of you, the staff and children, for supporting us in our work. And God bless you all. Wish you all a very happy Christmas.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father, for your words of wisdom. Every day brings a chance for us to draw in a breath and dance. Dance is surely the most relevant and basic of all forms of expression. Nothing else can so effectively give outward form to an inner experience. How spectacular is this day and the vibrations we are all experiencing. Get ready for even more delight and happiness. Save your excitement, everyone, for you are going to eye on some amazing sights and great dance performances. Now, without any further ado, let us gear up for an enchanting dance finale to enhance our Christmas cheer.
On behalf of the small children, about 54 kids are there, and you children have contributed for their well-being. God bless you all for it. Miss Sarojini. So the Young Women's Christian Association are taking care of these 54 children and old age people. So we just give them a small token of love to them. Yes, ma'am. Please receive it with love from our children, St. Michael's Academy. Thank you for coming all the way. Thank you so much. And we have another old age trust called Tanzova. The GM himself has come from them, Mr. Ramachandran. It's called the Tanzova Adhravu Illam. We are giving them a small token of love and also giving them a shelter which will be constructed in near future. Thank you so much, sir, for coming and gracing the occasion. Thank you so much. Thank you, brothers. Thank you so much.
Yes. Christmas is a wonderful time to reflect and be grateful for all we have received. Christmas is filled with thrilling wonders and joy of the season. Our heart swells with deepest gratitude for the spirit of sharing, caring, happiness and love. Christmas comes with renewed hope and courage to rediscover the strength of love
and reason to be thankful to everyone for standing with us in making this assembly a successful one. May I now invite Anya Lisa to pour out our deep heartfelt gratitude in words as she proposes the vote of thanks.
Thessalonians 5:16-18 says, "Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." First and foremost, I would like to thank Almighty God for the splendid weather and for bringing us all together to celebrate His birth, filled with joy and happiness in our hearts. I would also like to extend my thanks to our principal, Reverend Brother Thomas, and Vice Principal, Reverend Brother Isidore, for all their support and guidance in making this wonderful day a grand success. A special thank you to our beloved chief guest, Reverend Father Patrick Joseph, and our guests of honor, Reverend Father Prasad and Reverend Father Thomas, who runs a hospice for the dying destitute. The sisters and all other various representatives of other institutions for accepting our invitation and joining us on this momentous occasion. A big thank you to our teaching and non-teaching staff whose hard work and dedication in making this celebration an unforgettable one. I would also like to extend my thanks to the office staff and our beloved section coordinators for their unstinted support. A big thank you goes to all the teachers who helped in making this campus colorful and cheerful by setting up the splendid decorations. I would also like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to our music and dance teachers, Mr. Sushil, Mr. David, and Mrs. Reena, who worked hard to bring forth Christmas spirit to our delightful performance. Finally, a big thank you to all my fellow Michaelites for being enthusiastic and active participants in this program. May the season of Christmas bring joy, hope, and happiness to everyone gathered here and all the people around us. May the Lord Jesus Christ be risen in our hearts this season. Wishing you all a Merry Christmas and a prosperous New Year. Thank you.
This is the meaning and significance of Christmas. God never abandons His own. He is ever present. He is always there with us in all our situations or circumstances of life.
This means that no matter how hopeless and difficult our present situation may seem, let us continue to trust, hope, and have faith in the saving power of our God in the infant Jesus at Christmas.
His ever-living presence will never depart from us. He will always be there to protect, save, and liberate us from any danger or difficult situation in our lives. We only do what others do, so let it be doing good.
This festive season, let's make a difference to someone that needs us. Recognize the need in others, and it's not all about the money. It could be helping them to do their shopping, taking time to talk, to be there, taking them to visit family, cooking for them, or even inviting them in for a festive feast.
Volunteer and visit the elderly. Help the homeless or closer to home. Visit your family that you haven't seen in a long time. Write a letter, a real one, with pen and paper, not a send to all by email. Be personal, and get real.
Therefore, my prayers and good wishes for you and all this Christmas and throughout the forthcoming New Year, 2023, is that God showers you with the blessings of the infant Jesus born at Bethlehem on a Christmas day. May He never allow you to lose trust, faith, and obedience in His saving power, mercy, and love. May the infant Jesus strengthen you this Christmas.
In God's sight, it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas whenever we rediscover the simplicity of His love and bow down in thankfulness and worship, where we are and whatever our circumstances.
Let us rejoice and be glad, for
the true light which enlightens everyone has come into the world. Wishing you all a Merry Christmas and a prosperous New Year.
Thank you.
Baby, don't ring.
Day
feel like it's Christmas. Never wanna stop feeling like the first thing on your wish list, right up at the top. I can't deny what I'm feeling inside. Nothing to think about the way you make me alive. You make every day feel like it's Christmas. Every day that I'm with you. Look at the lights twinkling bright 24/7. Every inch of Central Park is covered in white. This could be heaven. And I don't want this a single thing. Don't wanna put into all this shit. But as long as you're with me, it's always the time of the year.
Everything that I'm with you. Oh, 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 oh. Ho, ho, ho.
Jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is riding a one-horse open sleigh.
Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the jingle bells.
For our souls. It moves us to think of others rather than of ourselves. It directs our thoughts to giving. Helping others while expecting nothing in return can bring lasting happiness.
There is nothing more beautiful than someone who goes out of their way to make life beautiful for others. Christmas is a spirit of giving without a thought of getting. The real meaning of Christmas is that it is literally more blessed to give than to receive. When you help others without expecting anything in return, you begin to feel fulfilled, complete, and alive.
The outreach program of St. Michael's Academy is one such program which helps us to foster the value of our school motto, receiving to share. Programs such as these help us to build long-lasting relationships, open more doors for us, and bring meaningful success. This year, we are privileged to help Tansova Adarave Illam Arumbakam, which is a home for the aged, orphans, and children, by constructing a shelter. Palam, which helps the underprivileged communities. Honey Home for Boys, Yasarpadi, Chennai. PP Homes, run by Young Women's Christian Association. Mercy Homes, Karunayalam and Little Drops.
May I invite our principal, Reverend Brother Thomas, to give away the outreach program's contribution to the representatives of these institutions.
Children, kindly disperse in an orderly manner for break. You can go for break. 20 minutes break. The children 6th, 7th, 8th, please wait. Let the children from the ground floor move first.
Morning. Very good morning to one and all. Children, you've been really slogging for the past few days for this assembly. It was a good show. And you also, along with your preparation, have contributed so much to reach out to various organizations, which was just read out. So today we invite people from St. Anthony's Middle School, Pudupet, Chennai, where we are giving benches and chairs for classes 1, 2, 3. The check will be given by our beloved brother. Please receive it, ma'am, sister. Those two children. We have two representatives, tiny representatives from that school. Yes, ma'am. So happy and privileged to have you all here. Please enjoy your stay here. We're so happy to have you here, sister. Thank you so much for coming. Then we have St. Joseph's Hospice, which is a home for dying destitute. They have three centers located in Dindukal district, in Chengalpet, and one in Tambaram. We welcome you from this St. Joseph's Hospice. Please, Father Thomas, please receive it. And we are so happy to have you here. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming here. God be with you all. Thank you.
Little drops. One of you.
We have Mr. Muthu Kumar from Little Drops organization to receive a small gift from your behalf. Children, you have given all these, so on your behalf, brother is going to give it to him. Mr. Muthu Kumar from Little Drops. Thank you so much for coming. We have another organization called the Palam Charitable Trust,